Christos Anesti.
Christos Anesti.
Christ is risen.
Truly risen.
The Messi come.
Hallelujah.
Thank you. Thank you for being here. That's about all I know. Thank you for coming tonight on behalf of Father Christopher Metropolis, our president here at Atlanta College Holy Cross. I welcome everybody here. And basically, I just wanted to say thanks for coming and to thank Father Emmanuel Clapsis, who is the Archbishop Iakovos Professor of Theology here at Holy Cross, for organizing the second annual lecture in memory of and in honor in memory of His Eminence Archbishop Iakovos. And I'm going to turn the evening over to Father Emmanuel. Thank you, Father.
Χριστός Ανέστη.
Αλλιώς Ανέστη.
Χριστός μας πέσε.
Ο Ιησούς πέσε.
Να συμβίζει.
Συμβίζει.
Welcome to the second annual Archbishop Iakovos Memorial Lecture. The Archbishop Iakovos Memorial Lecture is sponsored by the Archbishop Iakovos Chair of Theology in remembrance of His Eminence passionate leadership in ecumenism, interfaith relationships, and human rights. The late Archbishop Iakovos was the primate of the Greek Orthodox Archdiocese of North and South America, something that we tend to forget, from 1959 until his resignation in 1996. Archbishop Iakovos was one of the few prominent non-African American clergymen and the only church leader who had the courage to walk hand in hand with Martin Luther King during the famous march in Selma, Alabama. A picture of this historic moment with Archbishop Iakovos to the right of Martin Luther King was captured on the cover of Life magazine on March 26, 1965. I was deeply moved when I visited the National Civil Rights Museum in Lorraine Hotel in Memphis, Tennessee, and saw the picture of His Eminence Archbishop Iakovos with Martin Luther King. I felt that the Orthodox Church, through the visionary and dynamic leader Archbishop Iakovos, was at the forefront defending human dignity and fighting against racial inequality and discrimination. And for me, that was a great joy, and it gave me a sense of pride knowing that he was my Archbishop and I have learned a lot from him. He also became the first Greek Orthodox Archbishop to meet with the Roman Catholic Pope in 350 years when he met Pope John 23rd in 1959. He spent 9 years at the World Council of Churches and met with every US president from Eisenhower to Bill Clinton. Jimmy Carter awarded him the Presidential Medal of Freedom in 1980. Archbishop Iakovos died on April 10, 2005, and has been buried here at our school. This year, the lecture in memory of His Eminence will be given by Professor Angeliki Ziaka, who teaches religion at the School of Theology at the University of Thessaloniki. The topic of her lecture is Orthodox Christians and Muslims, interfaith collaboration, opportunity and challenges. Professor Ziaka's teaching and research interests cover a wide chronological and thematic range with regard to Islam, including early and medieval Islamic historiography. Byzantine and post-Byzantine literature on Islam, religious historical narratives, and the rearticulating of Muslim identities through religious discourse and political realities in the Middle East. She has published extensively in her field of research. Professor Ziakas is a member of several scientific associations. She coordinated the research project for Aristotle University's Research Commission entitled The Countries of the Arab Gulf and Europe for the support of research being carried out in the Arab Gulf and Europe. For the support of research being carried out in the Sultanate of Oman, and was the organizer of the International Conference on Ibadis and Sultanate of Oman. Professor Ziaka was the scientific coordinator for the training of teachers of religion in secondary education, Christian and Muslims, for the region of Western Thrace in Greece. She is currently the scientific coordinator of Islamic studies at the University of Thessaloniki. For me, it is a special privilege because I know her family very well. We have been friends, and I was in the committee that recommended to the University of Thessaloniki her promotion. And therefore, I had an opportunity to read her work and to admire, you know, the comprehensiveness and the wide knowledge of the Islamic tradition. We have to recognize that we have a good group of Coptic students together with Father.
This is a pleasure and honor. Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be in the Holy Cross College and to have the honor to deliver the annual Archbishop Iakovos Memorial Lecture. I want to express my sincere thanks to Father and Professor Emmanuel Clapsis for this invitation, which is the fruit of 10-year academic collaboration. I met him first in 2008 during a WCC consultation on Christian self-understanding in relation to Islam in Geneva, and he was representing at that time the Patriarchate, the Ecumenical Patriarchate. I remember Father Clapsis to fight, in spiritual terms, with the aim to give a more theological expression to the consultation's communique. Then I met him in 2011 at the School of Theology in Thessaloniki. I was lucky enough to listen to his lectures to our students on Interfaith Dialogue. He helped me once more to connect theology with interreligious endeavors, and mainly to make the distinction between interfaith and interreligious dialogue, and the necessity to act locally and at the same time ecumenically. Many of the younger generation of scholars in Greece are inspired by the work of Father Emmanuel Clapsis. The older generation of theologians are his friends, and they have traced a common academic but also ecclesiastic path to acknowledge Orthodox Christianity in terms of reconciliation, openness, and inspiration worldwide. Thanks to his invitation, I am very happy I met many other colleagues that I used to know only by name, younger and older. I can now say I understand their work and efforts. Holy Cross is a paradisian place, and during the liturgical life that I had the opportunity to share with you these very few days, I am glad to see that the students participate in the evangelical life and liturgy in a loving and complementary manner. I never thought I would have the pleasure to meet a Metropolitan who is a native of Harlem, New York, with such an alive spirit. through the work of the church in the Boston metropolis, a live and practical theology is present. I thank him and all of you for the excellent hospitality that you offered me and my son Gregory during these days. Interreligious dialogue is a relatively modern trend among the churches. Decisive steps occurred in this direction in the churches of Europe from 1960 onwards with the official launch of interreligious dialogue. That is, dialogue with non-Christian religions, notably Judaism and Islam, which identify with a common biblical background. This dialogue brought recognition, both symbolic and essential, to other religions, and in particular to Islam, which had for centuries been considered in Christian writings of both the Eastern and Western ecclesiastic milieu, at best as a Christian heresy, a corruption of Christianity, and at worst as the religion of the Antichrist and the armed struggle, jihad, for the propagation of its faith, dawah, that means call, invitation to Islam, against the infidel. The choice of subject matter for interreligious dialogue was not accidental. From the first, pride of place was given to the theme of peace prevailing on earth in accordance with the words of St. Luke expressed in the Christmas carol. Glory to God in his highest, and on earth peace and God will to all men. Interreligious dialogue advanced decisively after the Second World War, when, faced with extensive destruction and misfortune, humanity realized the need for mutual understanding and the peaceful coexistence of people and religions. Along with movements of populations and the growth of the mass media, an optimism arose and prevailed concerning peacemaking, communication between peoples, and the meeting of religions and cultures. Crucial in advancing dialogue between the Abrahamic religions were the World Council of Churches, which awakened the consciences of participant churches to think ecumenically and act both collectively and locally. And of course, the Second Vatican Council, with its proclamation of Nostra Aetate, in which the Roman Catholic Church made known its willingness to open a dialogue with non-Christian religions, specifically Islam and Judaism, and to walk on the road of peace in via pacis. At that time, the question was posed as to how best to regulate human coexistence in the future, generally, and what the common duty of religions was in this regard. It was the first time the Roman Catholic Church recognized the ecumenical movement, a decisive turning point in its own self-understanding and in its stance toward other churches. Many Europe-based Christian organizations started to develop dialogue programs for interreligious understanding, especially with Islam. Over time, Muslims began to join these different organizations, and these organizations had common personnel in key positions, whether or not cooperating among each other. A systematic lack of cooperation with Islam can be observed during the half century that precedes this moment, arising, for example, a lack of theological unity vis-à-vis Islam, the misinterpretation of the European churches to interfaith engagements, and the lack of knowledge of what was happening at the local level within the various countries in an ecclesiastic level, although serious progress was also made, and the preparation and maturation that would help progress in the direction of understanding between the churches. Especially in recent years, with the new influx of refugees into Europe and the activation of many NGOs as possible and paid mediators, even traditionalist churches that have viewed Islam in a virtual and stereotypical phobic way have engaged in charitable humanitarian work with all refugees without discrimination through the establishment of NGOs by the churches. This did not, however, extend to an ecclesiological level. This is also where the progress made by various church organizations can also make an important contribution in different local contexts. Churches undertook to implement an interfaith approach in the context of secular states, in particular because of their own needs and in part to fulfill their obligations within secular structures that offer them recognition and facilities, but also antagonism. Furthermore, interreligious dialogue helped churches to go farther than the missions and the association of many churches with political colonial interests in the East that had existed for several centuries. There remains, of course, the question of the possibility for the positive approach of the religious other using the methods employed up to now by the mission programs themselves. Can a religious mission overcome its dogmatic zeal and religious engagement in its encounter with religious other? But it's also interesting to see and understand how some religious circles of the Muslim world understand the historical evidence. An erudite Muslim man that has come from the Sultanate of Oman, and he is the minister of religious affairs and endowments of the Sultanate of Oman, notices. Dialogue between Christian and Muslim groups and organizations has been going on for more than a century, and there are major educational institutions in the Arab and Islamic East that were founded by Protestants and Catholic churches that played an important role in the Arab and Islamic Renaissance and modernity. These institutions went beyond missionary activity and established through dialogue a lasting impact on different Arab and Muslim communities. I want, he says, to mention in this context the good work performed for over a century by the Reformed Church in America and Oman and Eastern Arabia. Many Western and non-Western scholars have criticized Orientalism, seeing its work in a negative light of colonial and missionary endeavors. In reality, Orientalism did a major service by introducing Islamic civilization to Europeans and Americans, by highlighting the Arab and Islamic contemporary worlds as well as their centuries-old relations with the rest of the world. As far as the 1970s and 80s, an academic direction was also created within a theological framework which established dialogue between religions with the understanding and knowledge of centuries of cultures and religions, despite the distrust that still existed in churches, religious organizations, and theological schools toward dialogue between religions. Today, the religious dialogue, though established in many academic institutions, seems called upon to move from theory to practice and to contribute to the reconciliation of urgent problems to overcome in a critical spirit the intense and violent religious antagonism of the new millennium and to clarify the confusion of the times in which religions is seen both as abuser and victim. These institutions must in parallel find a multi-level approach to their students. Some of them are secular, other priests, an active member of the church, and not infrequently now, also members of other religious communities, including Muslims. They must inform them about the historical evolution and previous history of the religious dialogue in connection with the ecumenical dialogue, and to make them aware of the problems and gaps that still exist in an ecclesiological and missionary level. Until the advent of Islam in the 7th century, Christianity only knew the religions of Judaism and of ancient Greece and Rome, especially in the mystery cults of the Greco-Roman world with which it came into conflict. Soon after the 4th century, however, the ancient cults subsided, and Christianity came to prevail in the known world. So the need was not felt at first to develop a theology of religions. Things changed suddenly with the advent of Islam, a religion in competition with Christianity. The losses of Christianity in these, and later the retreat from Islam to Christianity in Europe, brought the religious world face to face, and of course, and generally, a negative understanding of Islam by Christianity. This relationship would become the model for Christianity's view of other world religions as well. For the Christianist, however, these relationships have many levels. They are relations of rivalry, difficulties, and bitterness, but also relationships of symbiosis, mutual tolerance and understanding, and most important, the exchange of cultural goods that generate the specificity of each culture, but equally those cultural futures that they have in common. The Ecumenical Patriarchate of Constantinople has had already paved the way to dialogue through the efforts it made towards bringing the churches closer together and bringing peace between people, thus contributing to the formation of the Ecumenical Movement and the WCC. Today, this dialogue continues to promote it by the Ecumenical Patriarch Bartholomew I himself, who, upon his enrollment on November 2, 1991, stressed on the one hand the importance of the unity of the Orthodox faith, and on the other, the supreme responsibility of the Church toward all mankind. The Ecumenical Patriarchate situates this responsibility in the dialogue with the major world religions and the preservation of the worldwide spiritual and moral heritage that honor all human beings. For this reason, the Ecumenical Patriarchate considers interreligious dialogue particularly necessary and essential. There are many autocephalous churches, Orthodox churches, and older and newer Orthodox patriarchates whose presence and activity is associated with the world of Islam and are part of our broader research, such as the autocephalous Church of Greece, the Church of Cyprus, the ancient patriarchates of Alexandria, Antioch, and Jerusalem, but also, makes a noise, that's coming, but also, and recently after the 90s, the patriarchate of Russia. The history and religions, their history and relations to the Muslim societies of all these churches and patriarchates are extremely important for understanding the present time and the violent clashes taking place, for example, in the Middle East, which also affect Europe and the rest of the world with large flows of refugees and terrorist attacks, and which will have an ever-increasing effect for a long time to come. Peaceful coexistence is what is desperately called for by the troubled churches of the East. The situation for the Arabic language patriarchate of Antioch, mainly in Syria, is extremely difficult today in a brutal, war-torn environment from which many Syrians have scattered and fled, Christians and Muslims alike. Although many declarations of sympathy have been expressed regarding this situation by the heads of various churches, their discourse does not seem to be effective in the face of these geostrategic upheavals in the wider region. And it's precisely here that we must ask how the churches will face the challenges of our times if they are incapable of effectively preserving their own integrity within these stricken religions, and moreover, continue to compete between each other, especially those on missions within the suffering areas. In the case of Syria, a variety of ecclesiastic stances have been and continue to be observed in connection with the fluid political situation of the region, as well as the political antagonisms outside it. Aiming at hegemonic tutelage, they have either maintained communication with the Syrian regime or cut off relations with it, considering it the source of the entire problem. In reality, though, neither the supporters nor the critics of the Syrian regime could preserve the local churches, which, although rich in confessions and historical testimony within the country, appear more allied between themselves within the Muslim majority than the churches outside the geographical boundaries of Syria, which have acted in many cases in contradictory ways in terms of a postmodern colonial way. The participation of the churches was neither equal, we see, and also nor qualitatively comparable with regard to the positive initiatives of recognition and dialogue with the religious other descendants of Abraham in the East as the Muslims. Thus, even though for the Christian churches of the East, coexistence with Islam was the norm for more than 40 centuries, at the local level, all churches did not develop interreligious initiatives for a variety of reasons. This was mainly due to the different political and regime realities and political balances in the living spaces concerned. It was also due to the kind of religious and national education provided, the creation or not of a space for religious diversity, the recognition or lack of recognition of the non-Christian, and more recently, the instability prevailed in the Near and Middle East. We observe similarly ecclesiastic stances in regions of Southeast Europe, the so-called Balkans, where the constitution of nation states with the gradual fall of the Ottoman Empire did not entail initiatives towards a corresponding dialogue either between the churches or between the states and the native Muslim populations. There were various reasons for this. Historically, the Muslim Turk had been seen for centuries as the conqueror by Christians, who by definition had been perceived by Muslims as agents of Christianity and of modernity and of secularism in many cases. Politically, religious identities were often considered pre-modern and antagonistic to the secular powers, and therefore often oppressed mainly in former communist countries, like Albania, Bulgaria, Yugoslavia, and other countries of the era. But there were also economic, national, and social reasons. Muslims were often poor citizens and often belonged to different linguistic families, with the result that all those citizens of the same country may have recognized religious minorities. These minorities did not adjoin, mainly because of national fears, equal participation as regards rights and obligation to the states where they belonged and lived, and of which they were citizens. Moreover, many national Orthodox churches were indecisive, inhospitable, and hostile even toward Islam, tendencies occurring simultaneously within the same historical conjecture and that emanate from different bishops, and this is the case even today. Of course, the effort to understand and to become familiar with the Muslims of Europe, Middle East, America, and Asia, and indeed of Muslims generally, did not appear out of the blue. It represented an already distinct understanding of the world on the part of the churches following the demise of the old empires, the old Christian missions turning inevitably due also to new circumstances that had developed in several parts of the world toward the Christian witness. This is the kind of witness which continues to take into consideration the command of the gospel, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, but which moves concurrently at the margins of the new secular and post-colonial requirements of the European states. Today, interreligious dialogue needs, as never before, to transfer the weight of interfaith initiatives to local communities with interfaith dimensions. Such initiatives have already been organized for quite some time now by churches, often mediated by universities and other academic spaces, but also by prestigious institutions dedicated to interfaith dialogue. But such initiatives have not appeared in all the churches, and notably not in the multitude of local churches. So what is required is an approach from the bottom up. The education of priests in matters of interfaith understanding and organization, educational and religious character, and meeting with Muslim religious responsible of the various Muslim communities. We believe that the results can be significant in terms of the mutual respect and the progress of societies, breaking taboos around religious diversity. In parallel, the ordinary cleric provides the social means to multiply the spirit of reconciliation for all those who practice religion, including the Muslim Imam Mufti or any of the leaders of the different Muslim communities. Such an encounter and such an effort may easily be achieved within secular structures to the benefit both of the states involved but also of their citizens, whether they practice a religion or not. Instances of Muslim refugees and immigrants turning to the churches of Europe or even the United States to find refuge are quite frequent today. The issue of Europe, of voluntary Christian proselytizing, of recently arrived refugees, but also of many Europeans and Americans to Islam, similarly remains of huge importance. An even larger issue, and one harder probably to resolve, is the rise of the ultra-rights parties in many European states. This is linked to extensive economic suffering and inequality. It is also identified sometimes with fundamental Christian circles. These I consider to be some of the major issues which will occupy the attention of the churches of Europe and the world, the churches of the world in relation to Islam, but also in relation to their very existence in the decades to come. Coming from the field of education, I have focused on the contribution of the joint co-education of Muslim and Christians, priests and laymen, theologians and imams, women and men, whether religious practitioners or not, or common issues, be they religious, political, or social. A religious education which respects religious diversity and makes religion a subject for study, developing critical thinking and common responsibility, is perhaps one bright path for our day's societies. Sooner or later, critical religiousness will also come to be discussed in the world of the Middle East, as long as there is a model and a track laid out to be followed. Interfaith dialogue is an educational and humanitarian tool. It needs for its part to acquire social and ecclesiastic status to understand and to go beyond an orientalistic approach to religious diversity, and to proceed to a satisfactory understanding and acceptance of the other, prioritizing shared responsibility and cooperation between the different religious communities in the world for the sake of the future of our children and all humankind. I will conclude by presenting you very quickly this lifelong learning program for Christian Muslim theologians of faith and issues related to the teaching of religion, and mainly the cultural and religious education, that the School of Theology has, let's say, lead 1 year ago, and it was a program that lasted for 12 months. And in the context of religious freedom, equality before the law, and equal political rights, the Hellenic Ministry of Education and Religious Affairs initiated a law in 2007 which enabled the Muslims of Western Thrace to be taught Islamic religious education in public schools that have witnessed the steady growth in the number of Muslim students in recent years. They don't go to the minority schools, that is the case for the old generation, they still go, but a lot of them, they prefer to go to the public school, the Greek public schools, and this has changed the realities and the necessities, even in Western Thrace, where we do have a mixed population of Christian and Muslims, and both of them are historical, let's say, native populations, indigenous. The subject was introduced as an optional module of the teaching of religion of Islam in the schools, public schools of Western Thrace, as an optional module. And for the same number of contact hours, the other people were taught array. Religious education is an obligatory subject still for Greece, for all students. And this was also, has led to a big debate during the last years. But we all have a religious education that comes from the state. 2 hours throughout primary and secondary school. The same law also made a number of imams public functionaries, granting them the same status as the and as they enjoyed priests. And here, of course, is the region of Western Thrace that begins at the end of Kavalah, at Philippi, and these all the regions that goes until the beginning of Eastern Thrace, so the borders with Turkey, and also the borders with, afterwards, the other borders with Turkey and Bulgaria at the same time, where the indigenous Muslim population of Greece is located. And here are some numbers for the minority schools and the state schools. On 2000, and also by the cities, in Xanthi, in Rhodope, and Evros. In the primary education, we have, let's say, 5,500 students. In the minority schools and in the state schools, we have only 1,867 students, and it was by the Directorate of Secondary and Primary Education school year 2014-2015. But we can see the difference in the secondary education that we have only 1,615 students in the minority schools, and in the public sector, in the state schools, 4,037 Muslim students. So, because this lead and helped them to have access to the university. And the ethos of this minority was until recently to go to Muslim countries, especially Turkey, but also Egypt. But since Egypt, the last 10 years, has also a lot of economic problems, they cannot gain scholarships. And some of them, they still go to Saudi Arabia, Medina, and Mecca. But also, it's not an option for them now to go there, and they prefer to go within Greece and to have the possibility to choose whatever they like within the Greek university, that they are public universities and you don't have to pay. So it's a free access for everyone, since he has good notes and depending to its, let's say, to will what he wants to study. In 2013, after this law came finally to be applied, the School of Theology of Aristotle University of Thessaloniki assumed responsibility for implementing a program of training for imams, Ιεροδιδάσκαλοι. Ιεροδιδάσκαλοι reminds you something, the word. It's this word that we keep. Viewing it as an opportunity to showcase the importance and necessity of the school class on reaching the Greek public sphere. The school also saw it as an opportunity to connect with the local community of Thrace, a key geographical region where Christians and Muslims have lived together for centuries. The program had to be rather flexible and address the trainees in a broad and objective way that was easy to understand, attractive, conciliatory, and useful. It could not therefore be exclusively theoretical, employing obscure academic terms, nor could it have a narrow dogmatic theological context, since it would be intended for both teachers and religious persons in the region, both Christians and Muslims, and some people that they are teachers and are secular also, because this is possible coming from both communities, the Christian and the Muslim community. But they have an interest to teach religion from a variety of education and language backgrounds. At the same time, it would be addressed to two groups of teachers of Islam. And this was the most difficult part. Imams in mosques of the era and teachers who graduate from the former Special Pedagogical Academy for Muslim Teachers, who for the past 2 years had taught Islam for the first time in Greek state schools. For success of the whole project, networking between educational workers in the region through education and more specifically in the context of intercultural religious education had to be encouraged. Promoting feedback and communication between the university and the teachers of religions who are active in secondary education and providing equal training for all and access to program for education and lifelong learning would further enhance the project prospects of success. At the same time, this was not to be a purely theological training, but rather a method by which religious could share their historical wealth and act as agents of reconciliation in the public school and through the public education, the very same school. This would be intercultural religious education, fortified, however, with a satisfactory knowledge of the religions in the region and of their cultural contributions. And there exists a very big ellipsis. We don't have books about local Islam. The whole appreciation, we have from the universities, and mainly from the Christian milieu, that they have wrote a lot about Islam in very scientific and respectful way, but nothing is written by the Muslim minority in Greek, even for, let's say, for the base level of elementary education. And this was a great lack during this procedure and also during the procedure that we want to renovate the curriculum of studies of religious studies for the public schools. We couldn't find point of reference coming from the Muslim, indigenous Muslim community in Greek language. So this was an effort also to create the local voice of Islam in Greece in the Greek language so the people they could communicate between each other without enlightened mediators that they caused the majority of the times, and as the history has shown to us, many problems.